Our final speaker, Mr. Warf, comes from BARDA, and he will share with us his experience with Ebola response and permitting process. Thank you.
Well, Vaughn, thank you very much for inviting me to speak on this. I'm the only person that doesn't approve a permit, have anything to do with a permit. I am not actually even an end user of having to do permitting, but I represent that group in many different ways as part of the U.S. government's public-private partnership routine, because I partner with many, many other companies as they try to do things. And our latest and greatest activity on this has actually been the Ebola response. Now, this presentation is going to be really different because I'm going to spend probably 90% of it setting the stage about what it was like back in the fall of last year as we were really gearing up to deal with this, and then somewhat talk about what happened and how convoluted the permitting process is. I think that's been explained pretty well today, and then how we tried to execute it so that we could actually move pretty quickly. Because if it's not obvious to anybody, the permitting process works real well, but it is not a just-in-time kind of process. You have to plan, you have to submit, you have to do a lot of things ahead of time besides just understanding the regulation. So just for, you know, a good graphic everybody sees, to remind everybody what was going on, that nice pretty picture in the middle of the course, an electron scanning microscope of what the virus looks like attached. So when it happened, BARDA was in a unique position to be coordinating a lot of the activities going on. And this slide gives a summary of all the different places we had activities happening, either in the manufacturing realm, in the product development realm, filling of the material realm, and then everything's going down to those little stars on the bottom right-hand corner. So you can see that there's a lot of transportation and going in and out of national boundaries that is part of this activity. And so it's really pretty important to understand that as this was going on, if you remember the wonderful news cycle that we were under, there was a lot of just-in-time activities because they're trying to find an airplane that can carry a patient someplace from one country to the next. So this is what's going on. And all the countermeasures, i.e., the possible therapeutics that might be given to the patient, or some of the stuff that might be used to protect the staff are part of this. And that's what I'm going to talk about, is more protection of the staff than the actual countermeasures, but I'll have a little bit of both. So if you want to look at how many different government agencies and other groups are involved, this gives you an idea of how many different groups were playing with this process. And it's a lot of folks. And it's a lot of coordination, and there are a lot of depth in places like the NIH, where it's multiple pieces of the agency. And then there have a whole bunch of other people that are looking at it and evaluating it. And these are all over and above what happens on the permitting cycle. Because you see, it says CDC is part of this, but guess what? It wasn't the part of the CDC that's actually directly involved with granting permits. So it was a unique thing about how to get all the pieces of the puzzle put together. And I would like to point out, as Jessica has talked to us about what it's like to deal with other countries that are not listed, I would like to point out that the governments on the bottom are not listed. Fortunately, that many of the agencies actually carrying on the activities of clinical trials were government agencies. So it was going from the U.S. government in the United States, and we had actually distributed into the embassies, so that the embassies had control. So I won't say we didn't skirt the regulations. We actually took advantage of those regulations. And it kept very good control of what was going on. Although the exception to the regulation about it could be used for a declared emergency like Ebola, we kind of managed on that one too. But there was a lot of good coordination that took place, and you can see how many different groups had to be coordinated with this. So when it kind of got kicked off, there were a lot of companies that thought they had vaccines that could apply for this. This is kind of the mid-level, but at the very beginning, everything was in preclinical development. And so when you are confronted with, we want vaccine yesterday, and you have vaccines that we don't even know whether they're safe to put in humans or not, it really does lend itself to a crash course of how you move things around and how things go on. Now, I will be concentrating a little of my talk on this experience on actually the one that's listed on the far right that says New Link Merck. And that was a RVSV Ebola vaccine, and it is a live virus vaccine. A little more specifics on it. But in the end, there were permits required from it from the CDC, from the USDA, of course, going around in the clinical aspect from the FDA. The only people I think I missed, and they're not represented today, was actually the wildlife guys. We do have vaccines that fall into Fish and Wildlife also, so it's just a real mix on what's going on. But you can see there were a lot of people, there was a lot of triaging. All the vaccine, or many of the vaccines listed here, were put in clinical trials, and we moved them around or going into clinical trials. So there's still a lot of movement, even to this day, of the permitted vaccines in and out to the various countries. So in the VSV vaccine, you can look to what it was applied to in this particular place, and I want to really emphasize that it was the post-exposure prophylaxis that was considered. There were some non-human primate clinical trials that were done that indicated that if you had some reason that you thought you were exposed and you caught it that first day, first few hours that you thought it happened, you could actually be vaccinated, and there was a strong indication that the vaccination would provide you some protection. So that's really important to many, many of the healthcare workers that are involved in taking care of the patients as they moved into the United States. That one piece, even though that's not a therapeutic, even though it was not being given to any of the patients, was still an important aspect about how we moved our materials around over and above what was actually given to patients. So in that particular aspect, this is what it was used for particularly. It shows that if you got the exposure at that day of, you could get a dose of it and you might be protected. And I still would like to emphasize, they had some data to indicate this, but this wasn't a proven, and it still is not a proven vaccine, although it's doing very good in the CDC trials at the moment. So when you look at the other side of the picture of what could you have given somebody besides this vaccine, what therapeutics were there? And all the list is actually bigger at this point in time. Back in that early fall time period, this was what was on the line, and all of them were unproven, and all of them were in pretty short supply. And just as an aside, so everybody likes to understand this, if you look down at the bottom or in the middle of the page where it says leaf bio, you look at those three different Y things, those are the three monoclonal antibodies. It actually takes three different components to successfully administer the therapeutic that has so far been the most tested down the line with success, although it hasn't been proven yet. All the time we're trying to manage all the vaccines and going on, we're still also trying to manage the movement of the therapeutics and where they're going and how to manufacture them. And so since this had so much play in the press, I thought it was worthwhile giving everybody a quick look at what was going on and how we did it. And this, again, we were working very hand in glove in how we helped the manufacturer or partnered with the manufacturer in their relationship to the FDA so that as things took place, the INDs were in place correctly and set up going correctly, that they were set up so that Jessica's team knew we were going to export it and where it was going. So there was a lot of real close coordination of how these things took place. And as we begin to really push up and to do clinical trials over and above the reactive side of it where we were helping individual patients. So let's get down to the final part of my story. So one night, it had decided, I think there was a joint telephone call with lots of people in place, that they were going to move a patient to Emory University. Now, between the decision to move them and the actual movement, I believe that's the good doctor down on the bottom right-hand corner, between that point in time, some therapeutic was actually administered in-country. And then the second part of it was that Emory University and all the people got together and said, well, we really would like to have a PEP, the post-exposure prophylactic vaccine, available for our staff because they didn't know what was going to be going on and how that needs to happen. So this is the sequence of all the things that had to take place. The actual vaccine was in Canada. Go figure. It was actually made in Germany. That makes it even more complicated. So the vaccine had to get from Canada into the U.S. down to Emory University. Now, there's only eight doses, so that nice thing Mr. Stephen showed about how you plug it in and put it in. It's a nice little box. It's, we're not talking about a huge movement in a huge container, but it's still, you know, not exactly like your standard FedEx package, perhaps. In addition to that, we also had to get all the alignments in place for the doctors that were going to be managing it so that they actually could follow the IND and the clinical requirements for a vaccine that just had its IND submitted the day before. Or I take that back, it may not even been submitted by that time. It was actually a provisional one. I think Jessica's nodding her head on that one. So anyway, so there were a lot of people that were giving their checks off on this one. So when it handed out, it was coming to a company that had just established itself, New Link Genetics. And so New Link was trying to figure out how to put permits together. Now, all the people here who are in the permit business know that a brand new person putting a permit in is not going to be the best filled out permit and exactly what we want to be looking for. Fortunately, it at least was going through a well-known carrier who was World Courier. This is not a plug for them, but that's who was bringing it in. So they at least had a good understanding. They shipped this in some extent all the time. So we had trying to educate a new company and to submit permits to both the USDA and the CDC. We had to get their people also coordinating with the FDA, so all this took place. And then it had to come across the border and go through CBP with all the right paperwork and then all the local areas looking at the paperwork correctly. For this particular activity, we ended up importing it three different times. It went through three different border points and it didn't work any of those times. And try as we did to try to notify people ahead of time, send emails out to everybody, it's a tricky process. And the paperwork is not necessarily complicated, but it is not easy either, and there's a lot of it. So it was very interesting, but the real thing that happened, and you know, in the comment about when you have something going and it's that data input at the time, 50% of our problems was misentry of data and figuring it out. Because CBP doesn't have the right person to call when they don't see it going wrong. They talk at the local level to the freight forwarder, and that information takes a long time to filter back. All the time, you've got the doctors down in Atlanta saying, where's my vaccine? What's going to happen? We're going to have a patient coming in soon. So it really makes for a very exciting couple of days and a lot of phone calls. Now, this was before I knew about Vaughn and the Tiger team that had been put together. And so there was a lot of phone calling of just various individuals in this, not as a group. Now, after this, there was a lot of pushback from upper management, government upper management, you can take your guesses at whom, about how we would make this work a little better. And actually, the Tiger team that it now exists is probably the best representation about how we do that and how we filter information. So the whole time we're getting Emory going, it is decided that we need to have a safety trial for this same vaccine, and that's being handled by the Walter Reed Army Institute of Research called RARE. And so the next step was trying to get sufficient vaccine into them to allow them to do that. And whoops, here we go again. It is a vaccine coming from Germany that's in Canada. So every time something happens, there was a new wrinkle about a piece of paper. And I mean, fortunately, one vaccine hit one border crossing point, and we were able to get back to the German manufacturer, IDT, in time for them to put their certification of how it was inactivated on the letterhead and shipping it. It was classic. But we finally got it, and all the paper went together, and we never lost any product, so I guess that's the real aspect of the regime. It just creates a lot of heartache for people as it moves in and out. So that trial also came in. We managed to get it. It was all handled in Washington, D.C., and it actually turned out to be very successful, and things were going along. Now, if you remember about the news cycles going on, we began to have more patients that needed to be taken care of than we had space at Emory and at the NIH. So the University of Nebraska set up to do it. Now, this is the first time they've actually been involved with this. So again, we have a whole series of activities. Fortunately, most of the vaccine has now gone past Canada, is in the US. But as was pointed out by the USDA, you still have to have a transport permit if you're going to move it from someplace in the US to someplace else in the US. And it still needed the CDC permit. Even though it wasn't an import, it was still a live virus vaccine, so we're managing it that way. A lot of people, a lot of writing of permits, and actually, we actually beat it there by day. Everybody managed to get it done. We were using the Tiger team by then. I was sending Vaughn information and the rest of the team, where it got pretty well pushed out very nicely and got taken care of great. So, you know, in the end, as Ebola continued to move down its path, we as a group of individuals trying to move it around and follow all the regulations we've got, managed to do it successfully. It wasn't 100%, and I won't throw a stone at the various agencies, and I won't say that, the various areas that were unable to figure out permitting and how to move it and things like that, because that turned out to be the stopping point. But part of it was the unwillingness of some end users not to participate in a clinical trial. So if you're not going to, you know, do that, you're not going to be part of the IND, the FDA will stop you. You know, if you're not going to follow all the various rules, and they are there for a reason and a purpose, then it really does create an opportunity for the system, I feel, to work properly, where we said, nope, then this won't happen this way, and that's what happened. And so in the end, the system, although it was challenged on the timing frame, i.e. how fast things went through, and the phone calls about turning around permits and having them actually sufficient to help the people on the borders that read it and did it. And let me tell you, every time it hit a border and somebody read Ebola on it, it stopped. There was no questions, no ifs or buts, it stopped. And multiple people all stopped to look at it. And quite honestly, I guess that's what we want the system to do. Because it could have been dangerous, might have been dangerous, that aspect were. So that's basically the end of my presentation about how all this stuff can be made to operate. We were pretty successful in that we actually ended up getting all the materials to the right places in the right time. So I'm the closer on this, so I get to say, we're getting ready to do the question and answer session. If you sent your question and answer in, I don't know who's managing for this, because I'm done. So who's leading?